I've just been quiet. I have to listen to my brother the way he systematically turned the history of this country to favor the narrative he's trying to post. So I think it's a very powerful one. But I, as an individual, will not stand there and allow such such narrative to go unanswered. I agree with the first point that a coup happened, took place. There was a counter coup. If you scored a football match, if you score a goal, and your opponent replied, that is 1-1. What do they call it? They call it a draw. You share the point at peace. Now, that has been settled. The issue of marginalization in this country should not be taken, should not be looked at with sentiment or with a parochial outlook. The fact remains that the present administration by the IPOP or by the Southeast in this country presently was triggered by the sitting president, Muhammadu Buhari.
How do you mean?
That will start. Our president, who ought to be a statesman, was asked a question. And his reply was, you do not expect me to do what? To treat the same people who gave me 97% of votes, to treat them the same way those who gave me 5%. That is for the president of a country, a united country, so to say. That is one. Secondly, for every individual who has been conversant with the dealings of Nnamdi Kanu, we've known him for a very long time. A hustler staying in London, trying to make ends meet through his own personally devised mode, who was relatively unknown anywhere in this country, came to Nigeria, and because of the ill-advised the president's aide, the president's advisors, he was arrested. I still ask questions. The rationale behind arresting Nnamdi Kanu when he came to Nigeria.
I think I can answer that.
No, I'm coming. I asked that question, I continue to ask. Because without, he was not arrested, the so-called sentiment, the so-called support that it seems to be gaining in the Southeast will not have taken place at all. That is one. Now, when it comes to the issue of agitation of Afenifere or the Southwest or even the region in this country, every region of this country has the right to demand for what they feel suits their own personal need. It is now the duty of the elected official to convey a forum where these individuals will speak out. You listen to them first. We're in a democracy, we're not in a military setting. This is not a dictatorial government. I'm coming. This is not a dictatorial government. You first call them, you listen to the agitation first. You cannot wake up and tell me, your fellow Nigerians, the National Assembly?
Nnamdi Kanu made some utterances, did some things, said some things that are treasonable. No government will fold its hands and allow Nnamdi Kanu to keep working freely in some land. Some countries or some serious minor governments would not even have allowed Nnamdi Kanu to set his foot on this country alive. That much I can tell you. Some would have neutralized him. Some would have devised.
We don't want to be those countries. This is a democratic country.
I know.
So let's not follow that narrative.
Wait. I'm shocked.
Sorry.
Let me say something now. You had your floor.
Well, then don't worry. Let him finish.
Neutralize.
But this is not that kind of country. This is a democratic country. We should not be talking about neutralizing anybody.
But I know the good thing about what this government did was allow him to have his name called. Yes, they did some things when the court pronounced they should be granted bail that was disregarded, brazen disregard to court injunctions or court verdicts. But beyond that, they did the right thing. Now, when you said they should give them the voice, to, as in give them the opportunity to hear their grievances or views, this is about the last election. The last election was the only one we had, where we didn't really see the overturn of elections at the National Assembly. And the way Nigeria is structured as we speak, those are the true representatives of the Nigerian masses and at that center. So as long as those guys were not recalled, elections were barely overturned, you can be safe to assume that these are the safest and the surest voice of the masses. Mm. And you see, if you want to, because all this thing is centered around the constitution, is constitutional issues. And the 1999 constitution, which happens to be our working document, empowers only the National Assembly to discuss such matters. So it's instead of you attacking the president or the government at the center, at least now we saw an attempt experiment with Dino Melai. You can use that to hold on your representative liable that if you don't do this or bring this to the floor of the National Assembly, either the Green Chamber or the Red Carpet Chamber, we set a motion of recall.
All right, let's move on from that now. I think everybody has a valid point. Everybody also has points that, of course, I don't necessarily agree with. One being, of course, I think it's unfair to say that people are not aggrieved until politicians make them say it.
No, they are aggrieved,
because
but
that's basically what I got from what you're saying. Politicians are the ones who trigger people. People can be aggrieved, and people should be able to air their views.
No, they have, but politicians latch onto
it. But you put a blanket statement that marginalization only comes up when politicians. I don't think that's a fair thing. But let's move on now. Let's move on.
Everybody share equally. I think that
will
not be aggrieved.
Let's move on to.
And I'm living in penury.
Yes. Let's move on to other things now. And I think I want to talk power. Because this presidency, one of the big promises they made going into government was, they were going to change things in the power sector. The last administration had privatized a few of these distribution companies and generation companies. And we brought in a super minister who Nigerians hailed at the time, Tunde Fashola, that he was going to change things. I can't remember the exact figures. I think it was something around 40,000 megawatts by 2020 or so. Mm. But at his speech today, Mr. President has revised it down to 10,000 by 2020. So I think we've peaked at 7,000 megawatts right now. I don't know how much has been distributed off that, but that's what we're generating currently now. What is the way out of this? Because we've privatized. We've brought in someone who we think can do the job. We have a president who's made it a priority, but it seems like nothing is working. I think we heard 2 days ago that the entire nation was completely dark. We don't know why we still have stories like that.
Okay, let me. I think one thing is very important. There was an error in the opening statement you made, and I think I would love to correct that.
Okay.
The Minister for Power said we are generating 7,001 megawatt in this country.
Yeah.
Presently. That's a very fantastic line. When this few days ago, when we had a national shutdown across the country. The Transition Company of Nigeria said Nigeria was generating generating around 4.3. That is 4,300 megawatts.
Mr. President also said 7,000 today.
Oh, the same Mr. President said that exchange rate is now 360. The same Mr. President taking glory for making exchange 500 and bringing it to 360 when he made it at around 200. The same Mr. President. I will not stand on national level and tell you the president is a liar. But what I'm going to tell you is that
you can infer, imply.
No. What I'm just going to tell you is that some of the statements made in his speech this morning were not accurate, and the evidence is there. It's there for anybody who has a smartphone and can go on Google alone. It's there. So,
but why can't we believe the Minister of Power if he tells us that?
When we talk about power, at least I did a bit of research and what have you. I can tell you that. Some people can generate as much as 100 megawatt if they go about micro-hydro power generation with pre-assembled parts and plants and completion of 5 weeks. And, over time, you can generate 5,000 megawatts in 5 weeks. But, you see, one fundamental issue which we should look at, and I'm saddened that this present administration that is filled of sons and lawyers is not doing the right thing. There's something called the National Electricity Regulatory Act that stipulates that if you generate 50 megawatts on grid, whatever, you have to transfer to the national grid. That is what is happening. That's why you can have private companies coming into this sector, come with their investments. And there's not, if you look at the tax rebate or about the timeline they give you to make your profit, how to go about it, it's not smart as a businessman to put your investment in, because you look at the return on investment and it's so marginal, you want to say, I don't want to do this. Prior to the energy Fashola saying we're generating 7,000 megawatts, it might not be far from the truth. I knew when the Mandela Power Plant was inaugurated in the 50s, there, but I think 1954, Mandela Power Plant, it has a projected generating capacity of 50,000 megawatts. Downward review to what have you. So, if you look at what we're generating, the Egbe terminals, the IPP in Lagos, the gas power turbine alone in Rivers State can generate as much as 500 megawatts. We've had states across the Federation going into such projects. But the reason why we still experience blackouts is because by the time they go to the national grid, the redistribution...
Which has always been the problem.
And the distribution lines are not inadequate, it's even obsolete.